politics and the pro-life cause. Results from an election in Kansas and reaction to President Joe Biden's pro-abortion push. Care for veterans. Lawmakers agree on funding for those exposed to toxins in war zones. A perfect gentleman, mourning the passing of a legendary Catholic sports broadcaster. And seeking deeper faith, why young Catholics from across Europe are on pilgrimage to Spain. On EWTN News Nightly for August 3rd, 2022. Thank you so much for being with us tonight. I'm Tracy Sable. Voters in Kansas have rejected a pro-life amendment to the state's constitution. The referendum was called Value Them Both and was intended to protect a mother and child in law. It marked the first election since Roe v. Wade was overturned. The initiative failed by more than 16%. The outcome leaves in place a state court ruling that abortion access is a right and could make Kansas an abortion destination for women from out of state. Meantime, President Joe Biden signs a new executive order focused on abortion, and it coincides with the first meeting of what he calls his task force on reproductive healthcare access. The pro-life groups say it won't stop their mission to protect unborn lives. White House correspondent Owen Jensen reports. Owen.
Tracy, as you know, the White House has been very critical of the Supreme Court's recent decision to toss out Roe v. Wade. In fact, the administration is trying to expand abortion access as we speak today. A prime example, this says pro-life groups battle back to hold their ground.
President Joe Biden joins a virtual meeting with top members of his administration, all focused on abortion.
We're doing everything in our power to safeguard access to health care.
The White House says the goal is to, quote, defend women's fundamental rights. In the White House press briefing room, I asked Press Secretary Karine Jean-Pierre.
So my question, respectfully, please, why does the president want to force pro-life Americans, including Catholics, of which he is one, to subsidize abortions?
So I'll say this. So federal law makes clear doctors must provide women emergency medical care, including abortion services to stabilize women facing and life-threatening conditions.
But it doesn't end there. Today, the president signed an executive order to support patients traveling out of state for medical care, which could have Medicaid pay travel expenses for women to get an abortion and ensure health care providers comply with federal non-discrimination law, which could force doctors and nurses to perform procedures that go against their religious beliefs.
There is a need for clarity around the rights of individuals and states in this moment.
Earlier, the president also sent out a statement praising people in Kansas who voted against a statewide abortion ban. He added, Congress should listen to the will of the American people and restore the protections of Roe as federal law. But the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops pushes back against pro-abortion bills, writing, such legislation places no value on the lives of children. And Stephen Aiden from Americans United for Life tells us,
they're pretending that there is a federal right or a federal interest in elective abortion after the Dobbs case overturned Roe versus Wade, and that is just not so. And I think that the courts who review these executive orders will come out to that conclusion very soon.
He also says the president is hurting, not helping women.
The Biden administration is promoting elective abortion that maims, hurts women emotionally and psychologically, and of course, destroys human life.
Now, back to my question in the press briefing room today. The press secretary also insisted nothing in today's executive order conflicts with moral or religious exceptions for healthcare workers. Catholic leaders, however, are not buying those assurances. Meanwhile, an update on the president's health. He recently contracted COVID-19, as you know. Today, again, he tested positive, but his physicians say he continues to feel well. At the White House, Owen Jensen, EWTN News Nightly.
And joining us now to discuss is Kristan Hawkins, president of Students for Life Action. Kristan, welcome back. Great to see you, as always. A lot to get to today, but first, help us unpack the executive order that President Biden signed today. Your thoughts on it.
Yeah, well, I mean, with the Biden administration, everything is up. Gas prices are up. Food prices are up. Inflation is up. And they want to see abortion numbers go up. It's actually shocking to see the fact that we are still, I was in Walmart this morning before my kids woke up getting groceries, that we are still experiencing a baby food shortage in our nation. But do we see the president signing something saying, hey, we have to feed America's children right now? No. He's signing now his second executive order with the attempt to get more children killed in the womb. And it's a political stunt, to be honest with you, to help boost his poll numbers, to boost his standing with the most radical part of the Democratic base.
You know, I want to go back. We mentioned earlier the vote in Kansas. I want to go back to that and get your reaction. Were you surprised at all that the amendment failed?
You know, we knew this was going to be an uphill battle from the very start. When I started door knocking with our team back in May on the ground, you're not going to erase 50 years of Roe versus Wade and the damage and the confusion that Roe has caused in one vote. And I think we saw, especially in Kansas, where the pro-lifers were outspent by more than seven digits. All of Hollywood and the left were incited to descend upon Kansas and to keep Kansas bloody Kansas. And they used deceptive language. I mean, I was watching TV ads where they would tell folks to vote no, but they had pictures of folks with masks on. And they said the words medical freedom. They never talked about abortion. And they almost made it seem like if you voted pro-life, you were pro-mask mandates. And it was so confusing and purposely so. And we see this all the time in the abortion lobby. They never want to actually discuss the real issue. And sadly, I think voters in Kansas are going to soon learn that they were duped by the predatory abortion agencies who are looking to keep Kansas bloody because they know they can have women drive from out of state, from states that move to make abortion a thing of the past and protect women. They're going to profit off of those other states. And by keeping somewhat hidden, you know, in invisible ink, constitutional right to abortion.
You know, Kristan, before I let you go, I want to talk about this. You mentioned that you were out there in Kansas, you know, door knocking. And I understand while out there canvassing for this amendment that one of your students was physically assaulted. Can you tell us more about this incident? And also, how is she doing right now?
You know, Gracie's doing okay. She went to a home, and we go in groups in neighborhoods, and a woman said, I don't think you want to talk to me. So Grace said, okay, and left. And her adult daughter, her 37-year-old adult daughter, then ran outside of the home and began beating Grace, punching her in the face, throwing food at her. Grace had to run to the car, lock herself in, and then call our team members that who are on the ground with her for help. She, you know, we took her to the ER. We got her checked out. I'm the Students for Life mom, so we wanted to make sure she was okay. She was fine. She had been experiencing headaches and body soreness, as you can imagine. But she, to her own credit, Grace got out there the next day and continued door knocking because she knew just how important this battle really is in Kansas and to speak the truth about how we should value them both. And so it was a sad thing. We've never seen this level of extremism when we've door knocked. I mean, I've obviously received death threats and, you know, we've received them in the office and we've had, you know, massive protests against myself and other Students for Life leaders on campuses. But to see this level of violence that was committed against Grace, it was unbelievable. She pressed charges. The woman has been arrested and we are meeting with lawyers this week in Kansas City to discuss pending action because I think a message really needs to be sent to the abortion industry. And this is something we're very concerned about as students head back to campus this fall, the increased level of violence and vandalism that, you know, we have seen against our own parishes, against pregnancy centers this summer and what the left has called the summer of rage. We're concerned that this is going to continue on. I mean, it's unbelievable. I was talking with some board members earlier today. You know, we now have full-time security guards. I have to have security when I'm on campus. But sadly, we can't have security guards anytime we go out to exercise our First Amendment rights to speak. And so we need to show the left, and especially the abortion movement in this country, you know, that, you know, while they advocate for violence in the womb, and we're not standing for it, but we're certainly not going to stand for it when they advocate and commit violence against our own advocates out in the streets.
Yeah, well, Kristen, please let her know we're praying for her, praying for all of you right now, and thank you for taking the time to speak with us. We really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
House Speaker Nancy Pelosi has toured a human rights museum in Taiwan, affirming an ironclad U.S. commitment to the self-governing island. The speaker's motorcade arrived earlier today, where the island's history of martial law is preserved. Later, the Pelosi delegation flew to South Korea, where it arrived safely. Meanwhile, in reaction to the Taiwan visit, China scheduled military exercises for tomorrow near the island's defense perimeter. And joining us now to discuss is Dustin Carmack, chief of staff to the former director of national intelligence and research fellow at the Heritage Foundation. Dustin, welcome. Great to be with you. As mentioned, China is conducting military drills. Taiwan says that 27 Chinese aircrafts entered its air defense zone. And this comes as the group of seven nations are calling on China to resolve the tension around Taiwan peacefully. How do you see this playing out? And do you think that a peaceful resolution can be reached?
This doesn't surprise me at all. I think in light of what happened with the leaking of her trip and essentially the oxygen to fuel this fire of Xi and the CCP to be able to amplify this over the last few weeks, essentially, I'm not surprised by the actions that they're taking in the days ahead. I'm not condoning it by any means, but, you know, they didn't engage her aircraft upon landing and some of the things that, you know, some people were trying to speculate about. But I do see tensions, and now in the next, you know, starting today and going forward, to be amplified, especially with these exercises that essentially are happening around all 360 degrees around Taiwan, including through air. There's, you know, military exercises on China's mainland and then by sea with live fire exercises.
And Dustin, what do you think our response should be, the United States?
You know, I think the United States, you know, should stand firm with Taiwan. And, you know, I think this administration, they've been trying to kind of play cleanup on aisle nine with some of their messaging because, you know, initially there was kind of sniping coming from the White House through different elements, you know, saying that the president wasn't happy with the speaker going on this trip. And now in the last week or so, you know, Admiral Kirby, who works at the National Security Council now, has been, you know, trying to really straddle that line to say that, you know, they're supportive of the speaker's trip. You know, it's a co-equal, you know, member of part, you know, of our government that should have, you know, access to Taiwan. And I think the speaker had every right to go. You know, this is not the first time, you know, Newt Gingrich, the speaker, went in 1997, and members go all the time. So this should, you know, this amplification of this, you know, has been really by the, you know, the behest of the CCP and Xi.
You know, another thing, Dustin, I want to touch on is Russia. Russia has aligned itself with Beijing and said Speaker Pelosi's trip to Taiwan is a provocation. The Kremlin also said that China has the right to protect its sovereignty. I want to get your thoughts on all that.
Well, I'm curious to Vladimir Putin's view of protecting sovereignty when he continues to invade a sovereign country in Ukraine and has done, you know, a number of other actions over the course of his presidency and ruling Russia. So, you know, this doesn't surprise me. You know, same, you know, they've essentially become bedfellows together, you know, in their actions. And this goes all the way back to, you know, the Olympics. And essentially, Xi's ask to Vladimir Putin to not engage with Ukraine prior to, you know, the ending of the Olympics. So, you know, this is, you know, what will be interesting to see is if there's additional actions by China to coincide and help in certain areas with Russia, just as a fodder point against the United States actions and against the speaker's recent trip there.
Well, we're going to leave it right there. Dustin, thank you so much for your time today and your insights. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Coming up, Celebrating the legacy of a renowned Catholic sports broadcaster. Plus, new details in the Holy Father's travel schedule. A bill expanding health care coverage for veterans sickened by gases from military toxic burn pits passed the Senate last night, but it wasn't without controversy. Last week, it was unexpectedly held up by Republicans. Capitol Hill correspondent Eric Rosales joins us now with the latest. Eric?
Well, good evening, Tracy. You know, Republicans tell me at first they actually opposed this bill because they said that it lacked any spending guardrails. Now, in the end, 11 Republicans did vote against the bill, but majority of them did, so it's now headed to the president's desk. Well, it'll ensure that these millions of veterans will get the benefits that they need who were exposed to these toxic fumes from burn pits during past wars.
It's a major victory for our veterans who are suffering, who are looking for health care and who need the health care support and the benefits, but it's also a victory for the surviving families like mine.
Gina Cancellino says her husband, an Iraq war veteran, died from several forms of aggressive cancers. She tells me the VA nor the Marines provided any help. Prior to the vote, some 60 veterans, along with comedian Jon Stewart, camped out on the Capitol steps all weekend.
The American people have to understand the sacrifice that they've all made and that we have an obligation to make them, to take care of them in the way that they take care of us.
The $280 billion PACT Act will ensure veterans get the screenings they need, codifies new Veteran Affairs procedures and training for exposure detection, and removes the need for certain veterans to prove service connection to exposures. Veteran Affairs Committee Chair Senator John Tester and others tell me we owe proper care to service members.
Every day we wait, every hour we wait, there's another veteran that goes down, another veteran doesn't get the health care and the benefits that they've earned, and maybe just as important, if not more important, a family that's left out in the cold.
When it comes down to it, it's really the military and our veterans, the only thing that holds us together. It's the glue that holds this country together. Because that's a person. It's not, we don't look at someone in uniform. That's a Democrat or Republican. That's someone who's going to take a bullet for you and protect you and your family.
President Biden is expected to sign the bill on Monday. Now, we have some sad news to share with you. We've just learned that Indiana Congresswoman Jackie Walorski from South Bend was killed in a car accident. She was actually in the car with two of her aides who also perished in that car accident. Details of the accident are still coming in at this hour, but she was a big pro-life supporter who fought for the unborn. We've had her here on EWTN News Nightly often, and she represented the district since 2012. Our prayers go out to her and her family. Eric Rosales reporting from the Capitol for EWTN News Nightly.
Well, the leader of the Knights of Columbus calls on the organization to continue its work defending the family and fighting for the unborn.
A knight is a leader who stands in the breach.
Supreme Knight Patrick Kelly made the remarks during his annual report at the 140th Supreme Convention in Nashville, Tennessee. He also highlighted a Knight's initiative to strengthen pro-life pregnancy centers, and he urged members to continue to draw closer to Christ. And we'll hear from the Supreme Knight tomorrow on EWTN News Nightly. The Knights of Columbus is a sponsor of this newscast. Alvin Scully, the Hall of Fame broadcaster and practicing Catholic, has died. He was on the radio and television. He was the voice of the Los Angeles Dodgers for 67 years.
Hi, everybody, and a very pleasant good evening to you, wherever you may be. Pull up a chair.
Scully began with the team in the 1950s, soon after graduating from Jesuit Fordham University. Though he broadcast many sports, he was best known for his work with the Dodgers. He retired in 2016, around a year later, as a fundraiser for two Catholic groups. He was recorded praying the rosary. He died at his home in California. Vin Scully was 94 years old. Up next, Pope Francis reflects on his recently completed trip to Canada. Plus, why young Catholic pilgrims are gathering in Spain. Pope Francis says he hopes his recent trip to Canada will write a new page in the church's relationship with indigenous people.
Dobbiamo dare la faccia davanti ai nostri errori, ai nostri peccati.
At the first weekly talk after the July break, the Holy Father said the trip to North America was different. It featured a tone of repentance and reflection because he was asking forgiveness for the harm done in the past. Pope Francis also said healing brings hope for the church and for those in Canada. Well, as we told you earlier this week, the Holy Father's next trip is in September when he travels to Kazakhstan. EWTN Vatican producer Alexey Gotovsky is in the Central Asian country near the border with Russia and has a preview.
The official schedule of Pope Francis' trip to Nur-Sultan, the capital of Kazakhstan, includes the meetings with the government officials and participation at the 7th Congress of the Leaders of the World Religions, which will take place here at the Palace of Reconciliation and Justice. And also Pope Francis will celebrate Mass at the Expo Square, where he will meet a tiny Catholic minority. It is expected that 40,000 people will participate at the Papal Mass. But the Mass will be also streamed live from skyscrapers, giving the possibility to everyone to join. The Catholic community here is only about 1% of the total population of the 18 million Kazakh nation. The official religion here is Sunni Islam and Russian Orthodoxy. Different religious groups coexist peacefully here, and Kazakhstan also counts 40 different ethnicities. So, peace and unity here are the main values. During the Congress of the World Religious Leaders, the theme of peace and unity will be also addressed. Among the invitees are Patriarch of Russian Orthodox Church Kirill and leading intellectual of Sunni Islam, Sheikh Ahmed El-Tayyib. It is expected that the religious leaders will sign the joint declaration and will call for peace. This call and religious diplomacy is especially important as the war in Ukraine is also trembling lives of people here and sows divisions.
It can inspire
the visit of the Holy Father here in Kazakhstan is much anticipated. In Kazakhstan, Alexey Gotovsky, EWTN News Nightly.
Meantime, young pilgrims from all over Europe are headed to Spain. The gathering is part of the landmark's Holy Year, which had been postponed because of the COVID pandemic. For several days, young people from across Europe are meeting to discuss their lives and their Catholic faith. Joining us now from Santiago de Compostela is Elena De Andres, a Spanish pilgrim. Elena, great to see you. Thank you so much for your time. Can you tell us a little bit more about this meeting and what are your expectations?
Well, this meeting is because this year is like a special year, is Jacobeo. So if you do the Camino de Santiago, you get like a special forgiveness, let's say that way. And it's big right after COVID and everything, they decided to make like a special meeting with young people all over Europe. And well, my expectations, I don't know if I had any, but it's been great. We've been walking for 6 days and doing the Camino. And we arrived today and it was great. And I don't know, I've met a lot of people and it's been like a great experience. I'm very, very happy.
Oh, that is so wonderful. Can you talk to us about, you know, your path, you know, what was your path to get here? And also what motivated you to have this experience?
Well, I love walking. I love like the countryside and I've done it twice, El Camino de Santiago. But this experience was a little bit different because I was made to be like with my parish, with all my friends from there. And because normally every summer we do like a special trip together. And this trip is like even better because we're going with a lot of young people. We are in a super big group with like 1,000 people from Madrid. But we're meeting in here with 12,000 people.
And you mentioned that you're from Madrid, Spain. If you don't mind,
yes.
Can you talk a little bit about the situation in your country, especially regarding the relationship between young people and faith?
Well, I think it's great. I was a little bit like 2 or 3 years ago sad because I felt like young people wouldn't be Christian. But I think I was wrong because, like, at least in my parish, every year we're getting more and more young people, like the group of people that we are in there. We're like maybe, I don't know, 40 or 50 young people in there that we go every Sunday and we have like with the priest and everything, and they teach us, and it's beautiful. And when you arrive in here and you see so many young people all laughing and shouting and dancing, and we're all here to, for the same thing because we're Catholic. And well, I have like, I don't know if you can listen to the people shouting, but it's amazing. I think that that faith is growing a lot in Spain, and I'm very happy about it.
Oh, that is beautiful and so great to hear. Well, Elena, thank you so much for your time today and speaking with us. We really appreciate it. God bless you. And we thank you for watching tonight. For the entire EWTN News Nightly team, I'm Tracy Sable. Good night and God bless.